Hey everybody, welcome to another Professionally Incorrect. Today we're going to take a look at how to make an LCD screen inside of Redshift. I'll be using Houdini today, but that doesn't really matter. You can make this in any DCC that Redshift has been updated in, especially since Maxon has put their Maxon brick, or they're calling it RS brick, inside of Redshift now. It just makes this whole process really easy. No fancy math, nothing, just quick, easy kind of color compositing. So with that said, let's jump in to Houdini and Redshift. As I said in the intro, doesn't really matter what DCC you're using, Redshift in Houdini, Redshift in Cinema 4D, et cetera, but if you're wondering what my scene is like, I've just got three lights around the scene, built up like a little psych wall in the back, this like box area thing, and the LED screen, and then an actual glass panel going over top, and it just kind of looks like this saved in the buffer there. I think I might actually have the glass turned off here to get more of this moiré patterning going on. But what we're gonna focus on is getting this set up here. Just some nice vertical lines like you'd see if you put magnifying glass up to an LCD screen, split into the RGB values. Yeah, and being controlled by whatever image you want. So I'm gonna go ahead and hide this up here. You don't really need that. And I guess I'll keep the scene up there as well. All right, so I'm gonna turn on Redshift and I don't need bucket mode at the moment. And I'm gonna switch into my first camera here, which is this up close one, and start to break down this material a bit. So inside here, I have this material brought in, and I can close this one up here as well. Just something I found on Unsplash, I believe. I'll put the credits down below. If I come back out to camera two, you can see it's this kind of quirky, retro, bright, colorful UI. And if we get in really close, it's the individual pixels. And I'll just switch to camera one up here and pull on back so you can, so you can see it start to come together like so. So this is that texture there. I can just hit that bug icon and it will bypass everything and just show that. And then it's being split into the three colors of RGB. Here you're just seeing the first output of R if I hit the bug again. But going into each one of these is red, and then we're compositing the red onto it like that. If I turn this one off, come down here, hit this one, that's the green values, so on and so forth. So we're just taking these black and white values and turning them back into their appropriate colors, essentially. So we take that, get our base color up here, put this in the blend color, and then multiply the color against the black and white image so we get the correct values coming out. And we composite all those together to reform our image here. So this is just a color layer with all these piped in going into the layer color, and then we're driving these layer colors with a mask. And we'll get into that in a second, but normally you might do this with, say, a noise and try and blend, like a roughness map together, something like that. And if I turn this on here, this is pretty large actually. I'm gonna use a Maxon noise because I prefer that one. I'll go like that and take a look here. Scale this down a bit, so we'll see if we get the blotches of red coming through here. So it's the same thing. We're just using bricks now as our texture instead. So if I go ahead and hook up this brick to the mask here, you'll see we start to get the red spliced out like that. If I bring this one back in here for the layer mask, like so, now we're getting our green, and then separately, right there, like so. And real quickly, you'll see that we have our base layer set to black. Oh, you know what? This doesn't need to be set to add if you're seeing that. These can be normal. That was just from me trying to troubleshoot something before. But you'll see this is set to black. If we set it to white, all of our gaps in between will then be white, and then it just doesn't really work out the way we want. But you could throw in whatever color you want, kind of experiment, make it funky, piping this into an incandescent, and then this is going out like so. So that's the general setup I know I went through that fast. I'm gonna go into the brick detail a little bit more now and then regroup at the end. So for the brick, this is probably the most painful part. The reason I'm saying that is, and I'll go back in on this, is there isn't really a great way to mess with the gaps. I'm gonna quickly run through what my settings are here if you just are looking for a quick setup. Scale it down to 0.001. I think in cinema, since it's using centimeters, it should be 0.01. Yes, that's what I'm trying to say. But everything else should be the same. So scale, so the 0.001, or if you're in another program, you might need to adjust that a bit. As you can see, if I go like this, it begins scaling these up like so. Just come down to 0.01. You'll see I've got some like little bits of noise in there too. That's just to kind of make it a little bit more organic, naturally feeling like it would be in the real world. These pixels wouldn't be perfect. And so what's happening down here is I've got this half width every nth row, and it's essentially slicing these in half. Without that, as you scale stuff up, the gaps are just really kind of weird and hard to work with. So if I spread that up and I come into my gaps and try and put the gaps more, you'll see the gaps actually eat away at these instead of spreading them apart. So it's kind of weird. I wish Maxon would set this up in a way that it actually pushes the rows and columns apart and not and doesn't eat away at the bricks. I don't know, but I don't like it. So that's my mini rant for this tutorial. Anywho, going back on the shader, so we need to set this to a half width so we get that spacing in there. Everything under displacement, you can kind of just set it to zero, doesn't really matter. Inside your colors, set these to white. We don't need to do anything with the brick color because we can turn them off down here. So down here controls the alternating bricks. Just turn those off, don't need them. And then gaps, you want to set these to black by default. I'll throw down a default node in a second, but I think it's kind of like a grayish tan color. Yeah, that's all you need to do in here, set these black. And then these are the noise controls I was talking about, how I just leave a little bit in there. I found that if I don't have any noise at all, Redshift doesn't really like it. It gets like some extra moiré patterning going on, and it's just better just to have a little bit of everything left. So just a little bit of noise, depth, just a little bit of depth in there. If I turn this down, you'll see, maybe if I turn it up, there we go. If you turn it up, it starts to kind of smooth these out. So somewhere in this range here seems to work. I'm just gonna go to 0.1, so it's nice and clean. The size, as I was just showing, is the gap. If you go too far, it eats away the whole thing. I have found that 0.4 works the best for this situation. I'm honestly not really sure what Groove is doing. I've played with it quite a bit. Maybe if I wasn't using black and white, you'd be able to see a little bit more. Again, have found that if I go to zero or go too far in either direction, it kind of gets weird with moiré patterns in here. So recommend just leaving it a little bit. Same deal with size variation, just a little bit on each. And that's it. That's for one brick. Then you need to duplicate it twice. And if you're inside Cinema 4D, this might sound familiar, but I've come in here and I'm driving all of these with the values from this first one. So inside of Houdini, you right click and you go copy parameter, come down, paste relative reference. I don't have anything copied right now, so it's grayed out. But inside Cinema, it would be the same as, what is it called? Set driver, set driven? Yeah, that's what I'm looking for. So you can do that in here too, do set driver, set driven. I don't know if it's as clean as this because then it's going back out to another espresso and so on and so forth, but I've got these all linked up so they are the same. And I think I just play with the seed values a little bit as well. Yeah, so I just changed the seed values. I don't know why, I think it's just experimenting because the placement doesn't really matter for these. And then same with the gap in here, I've set these to be driven here. These I kind of set ahead of time anyway, but you can set those to be driven so they're all the same as well. So that's basically it. So if I turn off this one and I turn this one back on, you'll see that it moves a little bit from side to side. And the way we're getting that is our shift. So this is another reason why we need to use that half width shift here, is you want to move it either positive or negative in one direction. I have found just keeping it simple by going the same direction and doubling it for each of these is best. So for this first one here, inverting it is best. So for the first one, I did 0.02, so it shifts it to the right, 0.02, and then on the blue, negative 0.02, so it shifts away from the red, 0.02. It's probably not exactly physically correct because, you know, it has green, red, then blue. It should probably be red, green, then blue. I don't know if that really matters on the TV, but it looks bright when we go back out. So if I go back out here, you can see all the colors are starting to combine like so. I think this third camera, I've kind of got like a medium setup right there. And we get this nice natural moire patterning type of situation like so. What else? I guess I'll turn on the glass that I was doing before and show you all that really quick. So if I turn on this screen here, which is actually glass, you'll see we start to get some smudges and some more blurring of the pixelation there. Just kind of helps sell the realism of it. And if I go back into my first camera here, you can see we get like nice blurry smudgy looks around here. So I recommend making some sort of screen to place the LEDs into just to help with that realism. Yeah, and that's basically the tutorial. So when I come back out here, I'll do the same thing. Actually, I wanted two, didn't I? I want to do the wide one. You can see we get those nice moires with a little bit of smudging in there, especially right in here. We've got some smudges going on, kind of blending those pixels together. That's it. That's really the tutorial. It's taking the brick texture, compositing it with the individual colors, and exporting it and putting it wherever you need to go. So yeah, I'll swap this out for another picture that I have in here that I was messing around with as well. It's going to be all distorted because it's not the correct aspect ratio, but you can put anything you want. And then if I jump all the way back into camera one, you'll see that's like that. I don't know why I keep leaving bucket render on. Switch back into here like so. All right, everybody. Well, I appreciate you sticking through this quick little tutorial of how to make a LCD material. If you have questions, please leave them below. If you have any ideas of how to make this better, also feel free to leave them below. I love that. Also, if you like this, please like, subscribe, all that jazz. I'm not a good pitch person on the channel subscriber stuff, but yeah, I'd appreciate it. Thanks, everybody, and I'll see you in the next one.